Today we're going to be talking about closeness to God and how much proximity matters to our relationship with God. I'm going to be jumping into our scripture for today in just a moment, but if you have your Bible, you can go ahead and open up to 1 John 2. If not, it'll be on the screen behind me as well when I get there. But I don't know that there's anything more pure than seeing a child on the heels of their parent, walking right behind their parent, you know? And I know there's a frustrating version of this where maybe, have you ever been walking in front of someone and they walk behind you and they kind of step on your feet and you're like, do you not know how to walk? And I think there's two types of people in the world. There's people who know how to walk and people who don't. And some people just can't figure out the pace or how to walk next to people instead of behind them. But it's different when you see a little kid walking behind their parent. It's never annoying, except maybe for the parent, I guess. But it's something special because you see that the child is beginning to take on the mannerisms of the parent. You know, they're beginning to step like the parent steps, walk like the parent walks. And what I think is important about this is that the closer that you are to something, when you follow close behind someone, you begin to be molded to be more like them. You begin to be shaped in their image. And so I think for us today, this idea of on his heels, as the title of my message, on his heels, is really all about proximity. We're going to talk about the way following on the heels of Jesus can transform everything about the way we see the world and the way we live our life. You know, take this table and this stool, for example. On their own, they're great tools. I can use this to sit in. I can use this table to set my things on. One is a place to sit. One is a place to set some things. But together, they become something different. They're actually a teaching tool. I can sit here and use this as a tool to teach from. And I think it's important that we realize that these two things, when they're closer together, they take on a new role thanks to their proximity and thanks to my awareness of the role that each of them is intended to play. I wouldn't necessarily see it if they were further apart, but when they're together, I can't forget it. It's the only thing that makes sense. And so I want to jump into our scripture today and just talk about the importance of our proximity to Jesus, because I think it can change everything for the way that you look at your life. So I'm going to be reading out of 1 John 2, verses 1 through 8. Here's what it says. My dear children, I write this to you so that you will not sin. But if anybody does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. He is the atoning sacrifice for our sins, and not only for ours, but also for the sins of the whole world. We know that we have come to know him if we keep his commands. Whoever says, I know him, but does not do what he commands is a liar, and the truth is not in him. But if anyone obeys his word, love for God is truly made complete in them. This is how we know we are in him. Whoever claims to live in him must live as Jesus did. Dear friends, I'm not writing you a new command, but an old one, which you have had since the beginning. This old command is the message you have heard. Yet I'm writing you a new command also. Its truth is seen in him and in you because the darkness is passing and the true light is already shining. I love the way that this passage ends, talking about the darkness passing and the light shining, because really what it is it's wrapping up this passage about the importance of proximity to Jesus and what a difference that can make in our life and in the lives of those around us. So let's pray over the preaching of God's word today. If you'll bow your heads and close your eyes with me. God, thank you that we have an advocate in your son, Jesus Christ. I pray that today we discover that our understanding of who you are and the role you play in our life is determined by our proximity to you. In Jesus' name, amen, amen. Well, as the Grace City Leadership Institute director, I get the opportunity to play a lot of really special roles and be there for a lot of special moments in our students' lives. And one of those is to be a part of engagements and weddings. A couple weeks ago, I got to be there for the wedding of two of my favorite students to ever come out of GCLI, and that's Micah and Justine Patel. And I had an incredible time. Honestly, what I love about these weddings is it's not just the fact that these students are stepping into a new season. It's also the fact that they're bringing all these people together who we don't normally get to see on a week in, week out basis. You know, a lot of our students, they go on to have jobs in other states or maybe outside of Lakeland. And so the fact that we get to see all these people together is always pretty special. But I gotta admit, for this wedding, my favorite part of it wasn't at the actual wedding itself. My favorite moment was a story that they shared from their honeymoon when they got back the following Sunday. And so If I had to describe Micah in one word, I would say outdoorsman. He's an outdoorsman and he loves fishing. I would say it would probably be pretty hard for him to get into someone else's boat and to call someone else captain. That's probably a challenge for him. But that's exactly what they did on their honeymoon. They booked this private chartered boat to take them fishing. And Micah says, you know, it was a really great time until he saw them heading toward this group of mangroves. And he knew they were in a professional chartered boat, and so he didn't think he had any reason to worry or any reason to tell anyone. So he kind of sat there aware, but not taking on any new role. He was paying to enjoy his time with his wife, so he decided to stay seated. But as they got closer and closer to the mangroves, he became more and more concerned that this captain wasn't aware of what was happening, especially once the captain actually got out of his seat and walked toward the back of the boat. And Micah began to wonder, are we about to head into these mangroves? But he waited just a little bit too long to really make the decision. And unfortunately, by the time the captain came back up, he didn't have time to turn the boat. So Micah made the only logical decision and yelled out, "Take cover," to the captain and to his wife, and then jumped out of the boat into the water and into safety, and watched as the boat narrowly avoided a complete straight-on, head-on collision with the mangroves, just because the captain had turned the wheel a little bit. Thank God. And so he watched this boat collide with the mangroves. And the best part about this is that in his vows, he actually specifically made an analogy of a boat. And he had said, "I promise I will never jump ship." And I just thought, how perfect that it already happened. And you know, it made me think it's a lot easier when you're standing in front of your wife on your wedding day to make some promises than it is when you're facing some mangroves a few days later. I'm gonna relate a couple stories in just a second, so I'm gonna tell a kind of different story. But here's what happened to me with playing sports when I was younger. I played Little League when I was a kid, and what I didn't understand about Little League was that both teams had to play defense and offense. So I didn't understand when I was placed in outfield that I had to play defense. I thought I was getting punished. I thought I wasn't good enough to hit the whole time. And so I would get mad at my coach. I'd get mad at my parents. I was frustrated. And I remember just always wanting to hit. And I don't know if designated hitter is like a thing in Little League or not. If it was, it was never communicated to me. I think that would have made the whole experience a lot better for me personally. But as I grew older, I had given up Little League, but I did start playing soccer. And soccer, for me, was also sort of a frustrating experience for the same reason. Now, at this point, I knew, you know, I was in high school. I kind of knew that some people play offense, some people play defense, and I can't just decide what my coach wants me to play, right? So I was often playing defense, and my freshman year of high school, I was on defense, and I played with one of the best teams I'd ever played with. And what I noticed started to happen was I began to see that the players who were on offense were really good at scoring goals. And I kind of knew there were always a couple guys that if I got the ball to them, we would score. And what happened was I kind of gained this newfound confidence that as I saw their proficiency, I figured out I could just play my role, and it actually benefited the team more if I just knew my role and played my role. And so the difference between these two stories is clear. And if we go back to Micah and Justine's case, Micah was forced into a role that he hadn't planned for, wondering if he should take over as captain because of a captain that didn't know what he was doing. In my case, I had to learn that I could trust those around me, and therefore I could play the role that I had been trained for. And so my thought with this is knowing your role matters, but the thing that helps us know our role is knowing the role of those around us. When I'm confident that offense is taken care of, I can take care of defense. Knowing their role helps me know and focus on my role. And the same is true for our relationship with God. When I know that I have a defender and an advocate in Jesus, I'm able to know and play the role that I've been called to. I wanna share a story with you from first grade. And you know a story is traumatic if it's from first grade, because you really shouldn't remember a ton of things from back then. But I remember this. And I was in first grade in a school that was kind of a shared space. It was half a middle school, half of elementary school. And there was this whole hallway of elementary school classrooms, a whole hallway of middle school classrooms. And in the middle was this shared space with the gymnasium, cafeteria, some bathrooms. And those bathrooms were the only ones that we had access to throughout the day as first graders. And so there were rumors that went around the school that in those bathrooms, middle schoolers bullied the first graders. And what that caused in us was a pretty big fear that made us kind of have to develop a plan for how we were going to deal with this bathroom situation. And what we decided as a first grade class was that we would never use the bathrooms at school. And so what that meant was we had to have a plan. And we put together, I think, a pretty great plan for first graders. We just would use the bathroom before we left the house in the morning, and then we wouldn't have to use the bathroom once we got to school. And that worked really well for like half the year, three quarters of the year. But there was one day where I forgot to use the bathroom before I left for school. And I remember the feeling I had when I sat down in my chair, first period, thinking, I've made a huge mistake. Because now I had this difficult decision to make. Am I going to go and face the middle schoolers in the bathroom? Or am I gonna pee my pants? And I made the difficult decision in that moment that I was gonna pee my pants. And so it was gonna come eventually, but I sat there wondering, waiting, thinking, praying, and I eventually got to the point where I had to pee my pants. And as soon as I did, I had this realization of why did I not just get up and go use the bathroom? But it was too late. And so at this point, I have to come up with a new plan. I'm sitting in my seat and I realize, okay, this is happening. And so I have to find a way of escape. And unfortunately, as is the case with most things, escape was the furthest possible way away. It was at the front of the room, and the door was right at the front, and I'd have to run up to the front in order to get out, and I was sitting in the back of the classroom. So I jump out of my seat, trying to escape this space as soon as possible, and I run to the front of the classroom. And as I'm running, my teacher looks up, and she sees me running, and she immediately knows what happened, and she picks up her water bottle, and she throws it on me, and she goes, oh, class, I'm so sorry. I just spilled water all over Matt. I'm gonna take him up to the office and get him a change of clothes. Can you give it up for that teacher? I mean, I can honestly say I'm not thankful for any educator more than I am for that one. And I realize that there should be teachers that I'm more grateful for. There should be bigger impact that has happened in my life than that moment, but there is simply not. Because what I realize is that teacher changed my life from being the kid who peed his pants in first grade to the kid who the teacher spilled water on. And that was a dramatic difference in terms of the way that people perceive you. So I was so grateful for what that teacher decided to do in that moment, how quickly she thought, how sacrificial she was to embarrass herself and make the class think that she had just somehow knocked over her water bottle on me as I was walking. And here's what happened is once that happened, I knew I had an advocate in my class. I knew there was someone that if I stuck close to them, I'd be good. And what I wanna do today is just paint a picture that we need to have that same sort of realization with Jesus, that if we just stick close to him, we'll be good. That we have an advocate in Jesus, that if we just stay close to him, we'll be good. And scripture is clear that Christ is our advocate, and because of that, we need to stay close to him. And that brings me to my main point, which is this. My proximity to Christ determines my understanding of the grace I have access to and the abundant life I can live. My proximity to Christ determines my understanding of the grace I have access to and the abundant life I can live. You know, how close you are to something determines not just how clearly you see it, but also how well you know it and its purpose. And so the closer that we draw to Jesus, the more we understand the role that he plays and how forgiven we are because of it. So once I know the role that Jesus plays in my life of advocating for me, forgiving me, having grace on me, being my defender, it makes me kind of be able to shed the weight of sin, shed the weight of condemnation and stop feeling shame-filled and start feeling grace-filled. And because of that, I'm able to operate in what God's called me to operate in. The more we understand the role that Jesus plays, the more free we are to play ours. And so I just want to take a moment to talk through a few things about the impact of closeness with Christ. My first thought on closeness is this: Christ's closeness is for me. Christ's closeness is for me. Romans 3:20 says, therefore, no one will be declared righteous in God's sight by the works of the law. Rather, through the law, we become conscious of our sin. And then if we go back to 1 John chapter 2, verse 1, where we started at, my dear children, I write this to you so that you will not sin. But if anybody does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. So Romans tells us that awareness of the law is what reveals our sin. But 1 John 2 encourages us that closeness to Jesus is what actually frees us from it. So awareness comes through the law, but freedom comes through proximity. If I draw near to Jesus, I can experience the freedom that's promised. And here's what's incredible. Christ's closeness is for me. And that means Christ's closeness is for you. And that's good news today. I know so many people who won't step foot in a church, not because they're mad at the church, but because they're afraid that God or the church will be mad at them. And that's just not who God is. And that's not the church that God's called Grace City to be. This is a place for all people. This is a place for everyone. And so when we draw close to Jesus, we got to realize it's for me. It's actually for me that God's closeness, Christ's closeness is actually for me. It's actually for you. I get the amazing opportunity to serve as part of our youth ministry here at Grace City. And the name of our youth ministry is Grace City Youth Church. And I love the way that our youth pastor, John Lorenzo, has marketed our ministry, because that title really does matter. It's not a youth group. It's not a youth ministry. It's a youth church. And the reason we talk about it that way is because we know that our relationship with God doesn't depend on our age, but our closeness to God. No matter what age you are, no matter what you've been through or haven't, no matter what season you're getting into or going out of, you can draw close to God. I think one of the most heartbreaking things I see happen is as high schoolers are graduating from high school and heading on to college, and even as college students are graduating and going on to life, that there's often this sort of perspective of, man, maybe I've been close to Jesus for a while now, but I'll probably kind of have live my life for a while. I'll draw close again later. This is not for this season. This is for later. This is not for now. This is not for me. This is for later. One of the most heartbreaking things I see in our church is broken families, parents deciding together as they're on the edge of divorce, that closeness for Jesus isn't for them in this season. Maybe it's a later thing. Maybe it's something that'll come at a later point. And the thing is, Christ's closeness isn't for you someday. It's for you now. And the sooner that you draw close to Jesus, the sooner that you'll receive the benefits that come from that proximity. So we have to draw close now, and we have to realize that Christ's closeness is for us right now. James 4:8 says, come near to God and he will come near to you. Coming close to Christ looks like this. It looks like reading his word, having conversation with him in prayer, asking him to help us leave sin behind, repenting when we do sin. You know, there's really no better way to draw closer to Christ than by reading God's word. You can't be familiar with his voice without knowing what it sounds like, what he says and how he says it. I've been on a lot of missions trips, and one trip I took to Nicaragua, we played a lot of soccer. And the rules vary of different sports depending on what country you go to. And sometimes the rules can vary throughout the game as well, depending on what the score is looking like. But the thing about playing a sport in another country is it's a lot easier to do if you know a little bit of the language. And so I realized on this last trip to Nicaragua that there were some of our team that really didn't know any Spanish. And those people had a lot of trouble with figuring out why the game was being played the way that it was and potentially having a chance to win. And there were a few of us that knew some Spanish, and that helped a lot. What it helped us with was engaging with the game. We actually were able to play according to the rules and play the way that it was designed to be played. And so we picked it up pretty quickly. We were able to engage a lot more easily than those who had never learned any Spanish. And coming to church without reading the Bible on a regular basis, it feels a lot like playing a soccer game with different rules, with people who speak a different language. You know, if prayer and worship are our experiences with God, then the Bible is the way we learn how to understand what he's speaking in those environments. I spend time in proximity with Jesus throughout the week so that I can come into these environments and hear his voice here. I spend time personally in my home at Starbucks, reading God's word, praying to him because I want to hear him here, because I want to know what his voice sounds like. I want to be aware of what God's speaking, of what the truth of his word says. And when I know what his voice sounds like, when I know how he speaks, then environments like this make so much more sense. I'm able to engage more easily because I know the language. My second thought is this: Christ's closeness is not just for me. So the first thought is Christ's closeness is for me. The second thought is Christ's closeness is not just for me. And this one might be even more important than the first, because it is for me, but it's not just for me. 1 John 2:2 says, he is the atoning sacrifice for our sins, and not only for ours, but also for the sins of the whole world. And the goal at this point is to turn what's happening inward, outward. Have you ever noticed that the people who know you best have the biggest ability to point out your greatest insecurities? That someone who knows you so well, maybe a best friend or a spouse, maybe a parent or a child, they can say something that can take you out in a second. And it can be stuff that maybe nobody else is even aware of. You're like, nobody even knows that this is something that bothers me except for you. Or maybe it is something that others are aware of, but when that person says it, it cuts a little deeper, means a little more because they know how much it bothers you, and you know that's why they're saying it. And at the same time, those same people who know us so well are the people who have the biggest ability to drop a word of encouragement that changes everything about our day, to say something that makes us go, you're right, I can't handle this. And the reason why they're so capable of speaking words of maybe discouragement or encouragement is just because they know us so well. Because they know us so well, they're able to speak. They know what we're bad at, but they also know what we're good at. When I get close to God, I can know what he's good at, and then I can operate in what I'm good at for the sake of those around me. So my goal is to stay on Christ's heels so that others can come close to Christ by staying on my heels. The Bible says that Christ is the atonement, not just for me and my sins, but for the whole world. And I get to participate in that process. He'll get the glory, but we get to play a part. And I love the way that Dietrich Bonhoeffer put it. It says, the physical presence of other Christians is a source of incomparable joy and strength to the believer. And what I would say to you is if you feel close to God, but you still feel like something's missing, it may be because you've gotten an awareness of Christ's closeness to you, but you haven't realized it's not just for you yet. You haven't realized that God actually intended Christ's closeness to be for those around you, and that your role is to draw close to Christ so that others might be able to draw close to Christ as well. It's so important that we realize that Christ's closeness is not just for us. And so I live a life of proximity and closeness to Christ, not just for my sake, but for the sake of those around me. As I follow on his heels, others follow on mine. And when they do, they discover a path to proximity. If I'm living a life of closeness to Jesus, then others can follow along and discover that same thing for themselves. And my last thought is this: Christ's closeness changes me. Christ's closeness changes me. I'm gonna invite the band back up as I prepare to close this afternoon. 1 John 2:3-6 says this: we know that we have come to know him if we keep his commands. Whoever says, I know him, but does not do what he commands is a liar, and the truth is not in that person. But if anyone obeys his word, love for God is truly made complete in them. This is how we know we are in him. Whoever claims to live in him must live as Jesus did. And what I love about this passage is that it speaks to the idea that I'm identified by who I'm identified with. That my personal identification actually is wrapped up in my relationship with God. The presence of God is what makes me who I am, sets me apart from those around me, and marks me for every moment. You know, there's something so transformative about the presence of God. And I have friends that have come through this place, that have been a part of our church, that have come for a few months, come for a few years even, and they've loved the community. They've loved what's going on here. They listen to Grace City music. They love the messages. They listen to the podcast when they can't be here. But eventually, those things kind of fade away and they return to the life that they were living, and they're not really found in the house of God anymore. And I'm still believing for those people to come back and to develop a relationship with the Lord. But there's another group of friends that I have that has come to Grace City for a few months or a few years, and they've had all the same experiences: joining a city group, developing community, finding a home here at Grace City, loving listening to Grace City music and worshiping and loving the messages and the whole experience. But the difference with this second group is that they've had a transformative moment in the presence of God, something undeniable where they can say, God spoke in that moment. I know he did. Something undeniable where they can say, I felt God move in that moment. I know he did. And that moment changes everything. Because what happens is, once you have a moment like that, you can still go back to your life of sin, but it's never gonna feel the same. The sweetness of sin is ruined by the transformative moment in his presence. And that's a beautiful thing. So you can continue to live a life of sin once you've had that transformative moment in his presence, but you'll never be able to enjoy what you once did the way that you once did. And the bummer about it is, what I tell people is, you can never go back. Because they'll come to church and they won't feel like this church context is everything it could be either, because they're still dabbling in the life of sin. And so both of these things, the sin that would have never fulfilled you but was fun while it lasted, and then the new life that's been promised by God, neither of them can bring the fullness because of this transformative moment in God's presence. And what I love about these moments in God's presence, when we draw close in environments like this, is that they become stumbling blocks on our path back to sin. They become processes that keep us from being able to return to a life of sin. It's impossible to return and stay once you've had a moment in the presence of God, an undeniable moment of closeness with God's presence. John 1:14 says, "The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us." The literal translation of the words "made his dwelling" here is "set up his tent." And I love this because God doesn't draw close because he wants to fill a building, but because he wants to be among a people. He cares so deeply about all the relationships in this room, each and every one of us. And you may encounter Christ's closeness for the first time in this place, but you won't experience his closeness for the last time in this place. Because we are the temple, and God will set up tent wherever you invite him. That's good news. We take the closeness of Christ with us. I always tell our GCLI students as they prepare to graduate and they're frustrated and worried because they're leaving some of their best friends and they feel like they've built up such an amazing relationship in this context. They feel like they've made such an impact here. And they're worried about going on to what's next. And what I'll always remind them is the good news is wherever you go next, there you are. Wherever you go next, you'll be there. And what made this context so special for you was you. You made the friends. You decided it was the place to be. You aced your test. You built this environment. You made this environment what it was. And so you bring that same environment altering potential with you wherever you go. And here's what happens with the closeness of Christ. As we leave this place and go on to the next place and we go about our week, we bring the thing that made this environment so special with us, the closeness of Christ. And so the good news is, wherever you go, Christ's closeness is with you. We may experience his closeness for the first time in this place, but it's not the last time. In this place, we have the benefit of having so many people who are living on the heels of Jesus. Our incredible worship team, our pastors, our volunteer team leaders, our city group leaders, our friends that we've developed relationship with in this place. And we have the benefit of having so many people around us who are following on the heels of Christ. And we can follow on their heels in order to get onto the path of proximity toward Christ. And eventually we become people who are living on his heels with other people following on ours and experiencing the path to proximity. Isn't that what the community of God is all about? That I would be following on his heels so you can follow on my heels, someone else can follow on your heels, so someone else can follow on their heels. This process, this path to proximity, it starts with you. Christ's closeness is for you, but it's not just for you. And Christ's closeness will change you to where you can actually have an impact on the lives of those around us. So before we leave, I just want us to spend a moment just pressing in, drawing near to Christ as he draws near to us, that we might walk out of here closer than ever to our advocate, our defender, our savior. Let's let his closeness mark this moment so that his closeness can mark every moment. Would you stand up to your feet?